Hello students, looking at current affairs for 16th April, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 8. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, industries operating in rural areas to open on April 20. So, Home Ministry has come up with a notification and this is a fresh order issued on 15th April, which is giving some relaxations to industries to operate to, plus providing some mandatory requirements like wearing face masks and covers is now compulsory in public places and workplaces. Spitting in public is a punishable offense. Selling liquor, gutkha, tobacco is strictly prohibited. People violating quarantine will be punished under section 188 of IPC, which prescribes 6 months in imprisonment. So these are some of the compulsory requirements from people to be followed. Then MGNREGA, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, the MGNREGA scheme, which provides 100 days of minimum work to rural households, is also being allowed now, so long as social distancing and use of masks are strictly enforced. Also, pharmaceuticals, other essential sectors like agriculture, mining, fertilizers have already been exempted from lockdown, but now new industries will be permitted to function from April 20. So, all industries operating in rural areas will be allowed to reopen on April 20 if they follow social distancing norms and other safeguards. E-commerce companies will be allowed to operate, couriers, oil and gas exploration, refineries, food processing in rural areas, jute industries would be allowed. Even construction of roads, irrigation projects, buildings in rural areas will be permitted. Brick kilns in rural areas will be permitted. In urban areas, only in-situ construction projects will be allowed if workers are available on the site. Then other industries which will be allowed, you can see, are renewable energy projects, even manufacturing and other industrial activities in SEZs, special economic zones, or export-oriented units, EOUs, they would also be allowed. So they can also be reopened, but workers should stay within the premises or in adjacent buildings. Then small service providers like electricians, plumbers, IT repair, motor mechanics, carpenters will also be allowed. The editorial today speaks of even allowing tailors, because in times when masks are needed, tailors can also play an important role. Then other industries which will be allowed, you can see, are grocery stores, vegetable, fruit carts, e-commerce companies. They would be allowed without time restriction. So that has been announced by the central government. Also, all goods traffic will be allowed to ply with two drivers and one helper. And truck repair shops, dhabas on highways will also be allowed to function. IT enabled services will be allowed to operate at 50% strength, while IT hardware manufacturers, for them, they have also been added that they will also be exempted. So SOP is also there for factories and office establishments that from April 20, medical insurance is mandatory for workers. Also, workplaces, it is said, should have a gap of 1 hour between shifts. And lunch breaks should be staggered. Everybody should not go out for lunch at the same time to ensure social distancing. And all organizations should sanitize workplace. Thermal screening of all entering and leaving the work premises will be mandatory according to the SOP. And work units should encourage use of staircases, because lifts would also help result in social distancing becoming difficult to follow. Work hours also, it suggests, should be staggered to ensure social distancing, and ban on entry of non-essential visitors in work units. Also, travel by air, rail, metro, public buses, taxis, cab aggregators will remain suspended. So these are also places where people come together, so social distancing cannot be followed. Even cinema halls, malls will remain shut. All social religious gatherings are prohibited till May 3. And there will also be a phased return of offices to governments as such too. So government workforce will also return, and new guidelines are there will be 100% attendance from required from officers above the deputy secretary level, while junior staff attendance should be of 33%. And in containment zones or hotspots, there will be strict perimeter control too, and state governments may impose stricter measures too, as required based on local scenario. And states will decide if additional public activities could be allowed too. So restrictions as well as relaxations, states will decide further, is what the Union Home Ministry circular says. Also, in another letter, Union Home Secretary has said the guidelines would be withdrawn immediately if any lockdown measures are violated. This is the gist of what has been allowed and not allowed. Then next is 170 districts identified as hotspots. So Health Ministry has said nearly 1 in 5 districts in India is a hotspot. So out of the total 736 districts in the country, 170 are hotspots. That is, these are places with at least 15 confirmed infections or where there is an exponential rise in cases taking place. Also, 207 are potential hotspots. So this has been announced by the government. You can see the hotspots with large outbreaks. Tamil Nadu is said to have the most number of hotspots, 22. Then comes Maharashtra with 14. So 33% of the hotspots are in the 5 southern states. The next is US freezes World Health Organization funding over coronavirus crisis. So US President Donald Trump has ordered freezing of funds pending a review for WHO, World Health Organization, for mismanaging the coronavirus crisis. He halted payments amounting to $400 million last year for 2019. And World Health Organization, which is headquartered in Geneva in Switzerland, Mr. Trump has accused it of putting political correctness above life-saving measures. He accused World Health Organization of opposing travel restrictions to China, which he termed disastrous. That this decision of not having travel restrictions to China was disastrous. So World Health Organization's latest documents show that US is the top contributor with around $58 million contribution, and halting that payment is expected to affect many health initiatives of World Health Organization across the world, including in India. India, however, has refused to criticize US on this defunding issue because it says we are currently occupied with our domestic campaign to defeat COVID-19. And according to World Health Organization, March 31, 2020 assessment, India also gives contribution. India's World Health Organization contribution, the commitment is of $2 million, whereas China's commitment is approximately $28.7 million. However, World Health Organization's present budget, you know, what it calls for, what it has announced, it says that we get funding from mix of assessed contributions and voluntary contributions. So, assessed contributions is financial support from member countries of the world body, that is, countries which are member to World Health Organization. So, the contribution is dependent on member states' wealth and population. So, its World Health Organization claims that contribution from member states has declined over the years and now accounts only for less than 1/4 of its program financing, means less than 1/4. So, the rest of the resources, it says, is raised through voluntary donations. And major European economies are said to be bigger contributors to the organization. So this is there. Then next is Russian firm to donate $2 million to PM CARES. So in the first such donation of its kind, Russia's state-owned defense exports company Rosoboron Export has committed $2 million, that is 15.3 crore rupees, to the newly set up PM CARES fund, which is to fight against COVID-19. So Prime Minister's Citizens Assistance and Relief in Emergency Situations Fund. So, PM CARES Fund has been launched by Prime Minister Modi on 28 March 2020, putting aside the Prime Minister's National Relief Fund, which is already there in place. So, there is a separate fund which has been established for COVID-19, and it has said this will be used, the fund will be used to fight COVID-19 and other such health-related problems. So, in a significant shift now in India's policy, contributions from foreign government-owned companies may also be accepted, is what is being seen. Thus far, government had said that contributions to PM CARES is also open for NRIs, PIOs and international entities such as foundations, not government-owned establishments. Rosoboron Export is Russia's umbrella group for all defense exports and is subsidiary to the state-owned defense manufacturing company Rostec. And it is also the largest source of India's arms imports too. It has, we are purchasing defense equipment from Rosoboron Export, which is including S-400 air defense systems, stealth frigates, AK-203 assault rifle, etc. And in August 2018, actually, if you see the precedent, Indian government had refused to accept offer from several countries, including UAE, Qatar and Maldives during Kerala floods. At that time, government had said it was committed to meet the relief and rehabilitation requirements through domestic efforts. So now in PM CARES, whether Rosoboron Export donation would be accepted or not is to be seen. But government sources have said that it will be done. Rosuvaron Export has committed this $2 million. Then next is outdated census data keep 10 crore out of PDS, public distribution system. So this is what leading economists Jean Raisi and Ritika Khera have said, that over 10 crore people are estimated to be excluded from PDS, public distribution system, because outdated 2011 census data is being used to calculate state-wise the coverage under National Food Security Act. So National Food Security Act, you should know, was announced in 2013 and it came into effect in 2013 with state-wise ratios worked out, you know, for rural and urban areas. Because National Food Security Act says that it would be covering 75% of the rural population and 50% of the urban population. So if this is the target of NFSA PDS, then it works out to be total 67% of the total population using rural-urban ratio as of 2011. So India's population in 2011 was 121 crores. So PDS covered approximately 67%, that is around 80 crore people. But then if you apply the projected population for 2020 is 137 crores. So if you apply 67% ratio to 137 crores, then 92 crore population should be covered. But 80 crore population has been covered. That means that around 10 crore people, 10 to 12 crores people are being excluded. That is what the economists are saying. And it is said that even states have stopped issuing ration cards to new ration cards, including Jharkhand is a specific example being given. It stopped issuing new ration cards because central government quota, which is there for NFSA, it has static numbers based on 2011 census. So it is the number which is used. It has been frozen. So states also continue to use that number. They don't want to increase the number. So they have stopped issuing ration cards to. And 2021 census is the next census to be conducted after 2011, but this will also be delayed due to COVID-19. And PDS revision will be, figures would be, number of beneficiaries would be revised much later. So, number of people being excluded are high is what is being stated and is a cause of concern. So, this you can see. Under coverage, which is there in various states, shown. Then next is India to receive normal monsoon, forecasts IMD. So Indian Meteorological Department, which works under Ministry of Earth Science, has said in April that India is likely to have a normal monsoon with a chance of above normal rain in August and September 2020. So IMD, Indian Meteorological Department, issues two stage forecast. First forecast is in April and a more detailed forecast comes in the last week of May. Monsoons commence in the country starting from Kerala, which marks the arrival of the monsoon into mainland India, and that is on June 1. So the dates will remain the same, June 1 for Kerala, but over states further, it may be a little delayed. So monsoon is arriving late in many states and exiting even later is also what IMD stated. So we will have normal monsoon means it is based, this prediction is based on global weather models, which are pointing that there will be negligible chance of El Nino in the present year. So, El Nino, what is it? You should know about that too. And the other terminology is Indian Ocean Dipole. So, both these you should know about. Indian Ocean Dipole is actually a temperature anomaly in the ocean. And El Nino is also a warming of Central Equatorial Pacific. We'll look at this in detail. So, here we will see what is El Nino. So, El Nino phenomena and means El Nino is a special scenario. Generally, you see that in the Pacific Ocean near the Australian coast here to the east of Australia, it is warm water. So, equatorial winds gather here, warm water pools towards the west. So, and along the South American coast here, along Peru, it is cold water located. So, warm water, you should know, warm water is light, it goes up. So, the winds also carry this warm winds actually are carried here. So, this is the cold wind and this is the movement of cold water that lies along American coast. But during El Nino year, this warming reverses. The winds reverse. So, the warm water here makes the wind warm and this warm wind is carried towards the South American coast and becomes warm along the Peru coast. And this actually affects monsoon, because warm water results in evaporation here and clouds being formed and resulting in further monsoon along Australian coast as well as along the Asian coast, including in India. So this is a normal year. Warm water should be accumulated here. But what happens in El Nino year is this cycle is reversed, and this results in rainfall along Peru coast and drought in Australia. So El Nino phenomenon drastically affects Indian monsoon, and this is Indian Ocean dipole. So there are two phases, negative phase and positive phase. We'll see both of them. You can see. So this is along African coast and here in Southeast Asia. So in the Indian Ocean region, El Nino is in Pacific Ocean. So when Indian Ocean dipole is in negative phase, then along African coast it is cooler than normal, and here it is warmer than normal. So when there is warm water here, warm winds here, so there is increased convection, cloud formation, and resultant rainfall. So that is negative phase of Indian Ocean dipole, which is beneficial, while positive phase is rainfall along African coast, and here there will be cooler temperature. So that is the two phases of Indian Ocean dipole. So that also affects Indian monsoon. So what we see in the present prediction of IMD is that there will be normal rainfall, because there is no chance of El Nino formation according to global weather forecast models too, and Indian Ocean dipole is also which can increase monsoon rain, is also expected to be neutral state during the monsoon. So this is there. Also, another important change which IMD has made presently is that it has officially redefined the definition of what constitutes normal rainfall. So normal rainfall was considered to be 89 centimeter of long period average. Now this has, with an error of plus my model error of plus minus 5%, now this normal rainfall definition has reduced by 1 centimeter to 88 centimeter. So it says the country's long period average from 1961 to 2010 is 88 centimeter, not 89. So it has modified this definition. And India from June to September receives around 75% of the annual rainfall, and IMD forecast is also from June to September, but presently we are seeing that rainfalls extend up to October too. But IMD said that we'll continue to have predictions from for rainfall from June 1 to September 30. Also, last year's prediction, if you should know about IMD's 2019 prediction in April, was that monsoon would be near normal or tad below normal. But India instead ended up with excess rainfall, or the maximum rainfall in the quarter of the century. And it was due to torrential rains which happened in August and September due to unusual warming in the Indian Ocean. And the model which IMD uses for weather forecasting, its dynamic model is called Monsoon Mission Coupled Forecast System. It relies on supercomputers mathematically simulating and physics, of the ocean and the atmosphere to give predictions. Then next is South Koreans vote in national polls. So South Korean President Moon Jae-in's ruling party is projected to win in the general elections in South Korea, which were held on 15th April. The exit polls show that his party is going to win. The voters came out in masks and cast their ballots. And this is watched internationally because it is one of the first nationwide votes taking place since the epidemic of COVID-19 began. And South Korea has South Korea's ruling party has been able to largely campaign successfully because it has been able to tackle COVID-19 also effectively. So its successful campaign against COVID-19 has helped it in the elections too. And the last news is WPI inflation cools to 4-month low. So this is wholesale price index based inflation. It eased to 4-month low of 1% in March 2020 due to sharp fall in prices of food and fuel items because demand has been slowed. Last month it was 2.26%, and compared to this last year it was 3.1%. So WPI inflation in March 2020 is the lowest since November 2019, when it was 0.58%. So this is WPI over the months, wholesale price index. Right. and this is within the WPI, there is weightage given to primary articles, fuel and power, and manufactured products, and how inflation has been in each of these categories is shown here for March 2020. And you can see fuel and power has been in the negative. So that is it. Thank you.